This paper is actually a summary of my chapter one of my thesis. The title is Unsettled Narrative, Historiography of Archaeological Interpretation. So the aim of my paper is to identify and examine the reasons and development of critical theories by scholars to position the discourse of intertwined relation between historical interpretation and identity construction. I want to trace and build upon case studies where the past has been used to represent the present. This essay is an overview of different positions taken by historians about archaeology to supplement the study of history. Simultaneously, it will also discuss the interrelation between archaeology and history, which will bring out how archaeologists acted as intermediaries to explain the collective destiny of historical consciousness for creating an explanation for identity construction. Though the area my actual study is confined to the geographical territory of undivided Bengal, nevertheless, for understanding the broader perspective of theoretical explanation as to how different paradoxes of historical analysis have been conceived, I look at other areas where similar socio-political situations led to assertion of national identity and attempts to stimulate historical consciousness. This essay is intended to be a detailed survey of literature based on the thematic category of nation, nationalism, and history, to discover the conceptual growth of historical studies among the places that have experienced colonial interventions in their societies. So within this frame, I would like to trace how archaeological interpretation unites with historical analysis to create an identity. Also, what is the related politics and motivation which created an idea that historical interpretation promotes identity construction? This essay will try to identify the reasons for the emergence of the binaries between historical interpretation and its pivotal role in identity construction. Moreover, what is the role of archaeology as a tool of narration to raise the idea of nationality, describing the phases of history? There is much discussion on the different periods and culture as far as archaeology is concerned, but analysis of the politics of individual aspects and different methods of historical interpretation have not been addressed widely. Most scholarly work circles around the stratigraphic understanding of cultural sequence to construct its historical chronology. However, they rarely discuss its narrative practices, where interpretation depends on several external factors. For example, colonial archaeological practice defines the term as a study of archaeology under colonial supremacy. However, it also entails further inspection of its principles and objective of analysis. How the narrative has prepared and functioned. It may not discuss the advancement of archaeology within academic discourse. However, the questions about the framework within which archaeology is practiced and functioned most cases remained unanswered. Most previous works focus on describing archaeological findings and constructing their chronological cultural assemblage. However, archaeology of archaeology, a critique of the conceptual categories that underpin the issues of interpretation or construction of historical knowledge, has not been undertaken so much. This essay aims to trace these alignments of the historical interpretation as employed in the development of archaeological studies, both as a discipline and also in the theoretical level. The essay will focus on the encounters between different scholars in the creation of historical narratives. This comparative discussion will show how the discipline was formed by pertinent political conditions in a critical socio-political situation, which facilitate the creation of national politics and identity, more specifically a segregated cultural identity. Most of the available study on this topic has dealt with either from an individual perspective, strengthening the Western narrative, or making a critical approach to how the narrative was made due to external factors like politics, economy, region, religion, and gender. In most cases, it has been oriented with colonialism viewed as a reason to influence historical interpretation. The discussion is mostly framed on jotting down the points of colonial intervention on a particular culture and the reaction of natives to it. We can begin with a more specific discussion on colonialization and nationalism for setting up the frame to observe its characteristic phenomena, and later concentrate on India, explicitly focusing on the historians who were engaged in discussing the trends of Indian history as a compound component instead of breaking into several regional categories. So as discussed, the contestation among the perspective, one may ask as to preferable interpretation, what was the preferable interpretation model will lead to a linear argument for the complex understanding and interpretation of archaeology or history. There has to be a clear division to define the role of interpretation, whether it is purely functioning for creating a repertoire of knowledge or the purpose of manipulating the knowledge. Because argument on archaeological interpretation is based on its frame of analysis rather than merely presenting the facts. It left us with scope for politicizing accurate interpretation, which may not be the only purpose of archaeological interpretation, but as a theoretical base for political construction. In this regard, we can have an example of Michael Shanks and Christopher Tilley, how they have argued that Western interpretation model is not the universal model to interpret archaeological findings beyond European regions. It leads us to find an alternative frame that considers different stratigraphy of social and political dynamics. The authors presented archaeology as a social mediation through its relationship between observers and observed. This argument shows that there is a sequential development among the societies that have different phases of conditions of impact, its narrative construction. How we make divisions between the methods of inspecting culture and their different levels of perceptions. This leads us to the argument that there is always a politically biased notion of history or archaeology. It is not only the subject or its contextual analysis. We also have to think about the individual behind this job of interpretation. Therefore, we can say that context remains the prime concern for archaeologists for subjective interpretation of historical facts. It depends on how usage of archaeology can form a political understanding, specifically in the case of building up national characters. We see that the political construction of archaeological interpretation is based on a procedure that is not different from the selection of the evidence and its representation. It is a complex process to represent accurately, quote, the ideals and ideas which inform human conduct across the cultural barrier. So this complexity, perceiving different historical phases, as Partho Chatterjee has further argued in different histories, the nation and its fragments, colonial and post-colonial history, Chatterjee has explained this binary of the creative and powerful results of the nationalist imagination in Asia and Africa posited not an identity but the differences with the nationalism propagated by the West. Augmenting this point, Chatterjee has pointed out scholarly mistakes of likening political nationalism with the Western idea of nationalism. This leads him to emphasize the contradiction between the anti-colonialist and nationalist perspectives, focusing on how these two rivalries have produced their domain of sovereignty within the purview of colonial supremacy. Even before beginning their political battle with the imperial power, they divided the context into an incomplete understanding. This nationalist sought this naturalist sort their cultural milieu into material and spiritual domain depending on the claim of spiritual construction. Chatterjee shows that emergence of political consciousness transformed with religious imagination was the main force behind creating an imagined presence of the nation. For that, the examples were drawn from literary sources in which language has played a pivotal role. Though Chatterjee argued for an alternative paradigm of perceiving nation or nationalism, which does not fit the standard Western notion of perceiving the idea of nation. However, this alteration was not only confined within its political discourse, it was very much prominent in historical interpretation, specifically interpreting the history of ancient India. As the initiative of studying ancient India's past was taken by European scholars, but within a very few years, some native historians also started confrontation with the colonial narrative and were trying to project an alternative narrative. Dilip Chakraborty titled this confrontation between these two groups of historians the birth of colonial Indology. This meant even though there was a contestation for promoting the narrative done by the native historians, that was not free from the colonial contamination of theoretical analysis. Chakraborty has examined how colonial interest manipulated Indians to perceive their explanation while looking at the ancient past of their country. Chakraborty has mentioned what factors were functioning behind creating this historical dynamism of writing history. The critical elements of this dynamism were racial background influenced by language and culture, even at specific points, religious fanaticism. However, the success of these paradoxes can be measured as the emergence of nationalist historians. However, there is significantly less difference between the nationalist and colonialist, as the nationalist group has adopted the frame of analysis started by the colonial scholars in most cases. So the frame of analysis largely remained unchallenged as the nationalist historians were preferred to address the minor issues rather than the larger perspective of Indian history. This consideration of different treatments of historical interpretation diffuses an array of nationalist approaches towards archaeology and history. As a discipline, there is a thin line to distinguish between the writing of scientific history or archaeological investigation, as the earliest colonial archaeologists like James Ferguson, Alexander Cunningham, has created a textual interpretation of the subject. Mainly, they have attached particular histories into that subject they were dealing with. Though pure academic interest and activities have been conducted both at individual and institutional levels, that was also not beyond the question of political supremacy. Tapoti Guhathakurada, in her, sorry for my Bengali accent, though she is Bengali, so I have to take her name in a Bengali way. Tapoti Guhathakurada, in her Monuments, Objects and Histories, Institutions of Art in Colonial and Post-Colonial India, has demonstrated the convergence of the twined history of these institutions and archaeology in the early 19th century by exemplifying the transformation of the centers of institutions from an archaeological repository of histories to the repositories of nations' artistic achievements. Guhathakurada addresses the moods of convergence with the archaeological exploration and their historical construction. Here, Guhathakurada emphasized the genealogies of history and archaeology to mount an analysis between the archaeological relics and the frame of historical interpretations. Guhathakurada's emphasis was on object and its history can be implied to create a national character through art historical analysis. At the same time, these characteristics have been used as an agenda for political consciousness. Here, Guhathakurada explains how history has been represented to its twofold applications for creating national character and idioms and a historical chronology. So, in the conclusions, we can say the conflicts over the representations, manipulation of knowledge and identity construction have been correspondences of different European agencies. Edward Said has examined this appropriation of the European model and its counterversions as dynamism of power politics between the colonizer and colonized. However, Western demonstration of power is not always successful, as we see the analysis of historical facts is not constantly scrutinized. The colonized expressions are perceived as the victimized subject or kept under strict scrutiny, as Edward Said argued on Cultural and Imperialism in 1994. I quote, "The power to narrate or block other narratives from forming and emerging is significant to culture and imperialism. It signifies that the transformation of ideas is based on their representations, but those ambivalent elements of representations create contentious identities. In conclusion, it can be said that it's a narration and analysis define the production of historical interpretation. Accurate archaeological knowledge is scrutinized, structured analysis of facts and their representation. As there are always a tension between theory and practice, and archaeology embodies those contradictions. In changing configurations, the reflections between theory and practice, Ian Huda mentioned that, I quote, throughout its history, archaeology has tended to deal with this tension by being circumcised by theory and devoting itself to a common sense of view, which is a letter carried by Philip Barker, that to keep the interpretation separate from the evidence on which it is based, so archaeologists always functions by twisting the nature of interpretation, trying to grasp the theory to date a coherent of the interpretation. Thank you.